We might not have been recording, but I think you still heard us. So if you need to record the introduction, one more. Good? Okay, we're going to start. So first of all, today, oh, now we have this. All right, not supposed to be that challenging with this. And now it's working. Perfect. All right, so for today, it's a relatively compact presentation, and I was intentional with the idea of saying it's meant to be kind of framework and considerations as a primer. We're not going to cover everything in an hour and a half. That's not how this works, right? And part of this is these are meant to be points of engagement. They're meant to be starting points for you to think about what other types of support, capacity building, training, workshop, pieces that you can identify for yourself as an individual, as a team, but also as an organization, to kind of dig in a little deeper. And so part of that is the landscape view. So for the landscape view, the way that I'm presenting that is what is kind of the big picture in terms of the terms, in terms of kind of the direction. Like I said, it won't be all encompassing, but it'll give you kind of an idea of the space in which to navigate this. And then also, because during our conversations, we were talking about, well, what may be some places that I can start, right? If I know that this space is big, what are some things that I can look at to see that I can do work as an individual, but also as an organization? So I'll be talking primarily around three areas for that. One of them is the work around implicit bias and fragility. Part of that is because you can get some relatively really good tailored workshops and trainings from a variety of leadership in the field. The oppressive dominant work culture, that was important because it's not just about the individual work. It's also about like paying attention to when we talk about systems of oppression or like systemic components, and also really about just the culture. So what do you create as the space in which you relate with each other? It tends to affect everything from the work that you do, how it gets done, how it's valued, interpreted, and then who feels they belong in that space. And then lastly, inclusive narrative. This one, because it can be both one of the easiest pieces to start with, but also one of the most necessary and challenging, and that it's not limited just to like, well, what does our newsletter say? Or what do we put on the website? It's literally about how you communicate your work in such a way that by taking into account things like bias and other components, you're creating the space where other communities and folks reflected in the narrative that you're building about the work that we do. Okay? And so I say that because it's not just about the marketing team. It can literally be also be about the budgeting team. It can also be the outreach team. It could be the person making all the spreadsheets. Like, all of that matters in terms of the culture that you support. I guess it's going to continue to do. So let's try this. All right, and so I'm just gonna, the other thing is I'm just going to give you that scope, and I do this often, to be straight up and transparent and honest with you so you're not surprised when you're in the field and you're like, whoa, where did that come from, right? And it's also important so we get to kind of define some of the space, and it isn't an obligation per se of saying you need to start here. It is an obligation that you need to start, and it is an obligation that you need to make sure that you're aware of where you're going to move in that space. So I say that because when I show you an image like this, this isn't me saying, okay, so whenever you're going to start a presentation, make sure you're going to do a land acknowledgement and then use this image. That's not what I'm building. But it is important because part of the way where we're changing the narrative around, for example, presentation, is something like a land acknowledgement. And that in itself can take
a whole session to talk about the value, the importance, the necessity, and also the limitations. Because it isn't about just, we are here on stolen Ohlone Tshetshenyo land, and let's be grateful for that and let's move on. It doesn't work that way. You do have to start there as to do the work that's necessary when we talk about indigenous erasure, for example, and to understand what that means in the work that we do now when we say let's engage quote-unquote more diverse community, or let's be more considerate of participants that are not as engaged in the work that we do. And that's in the face of knowing that for, you know, 200 to 400 years, there was a systematic, deliberate practice of targeting communities, sovereign entities, as if they were not meant to exist, or we talk about them in the future as if they are relegated to the past. So that's the kind of shaping when we talk about when we begin the piece around introduction and when you see land acknowledgement. And furthermore, the important component is that we don't perpetuate that different types of erasure by simply saying, oh, yes, Native Americans, and we refer to that in a homogeneous way, in a way that can continue erasure, as if you're saying you're also just people of color, and forget the fact that it's a little more complex and nuanced than that. You're also looking at political and legal entities. Right? You have to look at which are federally recognized tribes and what does that mean as sovereign status. So, like, those are the kind of pieces that's important to look at as you begin to see why this type of work. Okay? But it's also important just to start knowing what is the ancestral homeland in which we are and how did this place come to be. Not from pure open space. The other thing in terms of agreement, if this was a much more designed as a workshop, then we'd be having all of you, both in the audience here and at home, working in groups, for example, doing a little bit more of the practicing. And so the work around agreements is crucial, and we would spend a lot more time to be able to say, what are the ways in which it's important that we're going to pay attention to relate to each other? So that's how we look at, but then also practice some of the basis of culture that is important for us. Really, why do we value and how do we value engaging with each other? I'm going to propose these to you now. Well, one is because if you're in the audience at home, I can't see you and hear you. But I'm going to propose these to you so you can also understand a bit of the processing that I do for agreement and how I work with them and interpret them so you can understand how that can also be a tool and a training for the work that you do. For the agreements, I look at three components. The first component is what's going to help us be efficient and successful. And these are not ranking by prioritizing, meaning this is the most important. It's more like these are three pieces. And we use that because we're still in the system that we are. We still have things to do on time. There's still expectations around when you're going to produce something and that we'd like to have some outcome or level of success at a meeting, at a project, at something, right? So the success and efficiency are still crucial, but it can't be limited just to that. You also, to practice this work, is then being able to say, okay, what is our awareness of who tends to be the most ignored, the most undervalued, the ones who are giving feedback saying, you know what, I don't think my feedback ever seems to make a difference. I wonder why that might be, or I'm pretty clear as to why I think it might be, and nobody hears me on that. The second agreements are around what helps us be seen, heard, and valued. And then the last one is, so what happens when an agreement is broken? What is our practices to kind of show that we're building some of the resiliency so that when we are going to mess up, not if, but when, that's just, we're human, and welcome to being people, we can understand and do the work of saying, ah, I didn't mean that, and I want to recognize and be aware of the impact that it had on you, how this hurt you, and why that matters so much to me in a way that I would have not known or noticed, right? So these are kind of bucket types of agreements that I look to try to capture a lot of agreements you may see in other presentations The first one is support positive intent and sense of impact. You'll see a lot of varieties around that. Part of that is to not get overly stuck and it's like, oh, I didn't mean it, or I'm not that kind of person. You get stuck into the personal characteristics, and it's too easy to be detracted from the fact that something negative happened, and we can actually do something about that. Rather than saying, oh, yeah, you're a bad person, so let me change you, try to make you a good person. And it helps us kind of separate some of the work that's in the, that's separate from that. The honor, passion, and compassion is part of it is knowing that when people are giving us feedback, for example, or something that we don't like, or you might hear comments of like, oh, they're always talking about this, this, and this. They're always making it about this, this, and this. And it makes me uncomfortable, or why do they always have to bring up these things? If you pay attention to knowing that when people are giving you feedback or they are sharing some concern, it's likely because it comes out of a place of passion or even love. If we don't, you know, nobody intentionally really wants to put themselves in a state of discomfort just for fun because they care about making a change. So we can reframe us together being able to look at why we're doing that while holding a space of compassion, which can be really hard at times. That can help us kind of recenter on the humanity we always talk about, but we don't often do it when we get into defensive spaces. And we begin the process of othering way too quickly. 3 is support difference and discomfort as a source of learning and growth. So how many of you here, for example, go to the gym or have some type of training program? Few of you, right? Doesn't have to be serious. You could just say, hey, I like to jog, run at least once a week or something and hit my 2 or 3 miles. So exercising, doing some type of kind of physical training, that is intentionally putting yourself in a physical state of discomfort. That's what working out is. You're breaking down your muscle to make it stronger. But I don't think, I don't know. I will presume that many, if not most of you, don't get up every morning and say, great, time to put my body in a physical state of discomfort, right? You're like, I want to go hit the gym, or I'm excited for my run. So translate to knowing that discomfort in these other spaces, if your first inclination is just to kind of run away or shy and say, ooh, uncomfortable, I don't want that, think about how you frame this as the work that's needed and knowing that it does come with a level of social emotional discomfort. And it isn't also about just putting yourself to say, oh, great, it's uncomfortable, so it's okay, let me just jump in. Because just like when you go to the gym, you don't say, great, there's the heaviest thing, I'm going to go lift that, because that's how we get strong. That is how you hurt yourself. So want us to intentionally pay attention to what is this in service of, and how does it serve as a source of learning and growth, making those muscles stronger. 4 is commit to ego check. Simple to say, but hard to do. This is about looking where my biases come from. Why is something important to me? What is the little voice saying, like, pay attention to this and not to that? This is more valuable than this and not that. This is also part of the Hermes principles, for example, to kind of say to commit to self-transformation, right? And if you like the quotes, just ground it in the be the change that you want to see in the world, right? But it is the work. It isn't just a quote. It is the work. And that can help doing the model and practicing that's necessary often to do this work rather than the telling and punishing that we think is going to get the result. We are often pretty good about being driven by negative stuff because survival mode is evolutionary, but that doesn't get us to kind of the space that we really want to be in. And then the last one, this is important because a lot of times, speaking of telling and punishing, we kind of have all of these, like, do this hard work and, like, transform yourself in this dramatic way. And then it can be grounded in some of the simple practices. So we have to practice liberated joy because think about the time when you played. And you played with friends or we played with other people. What is that state of play? On a spectrum of how we relate to each other, on one end we have the most extreme dramatic example, which is, for example, genocide, right? Wanting to exterminate the other. We have constructed a whole set of, like, this other individual is not like me, right? It's less than me, and they do not deserve to exist. And it sounds harsh, but that is what we have done as humans to each other at times. Whereas on another end of the spectrum, and in between there, we can have like tolerance, you know, kind of just putting up with you, some form of acceptance. But joy, on the other hand, is that play factor where it's like, imagine what it was to play with someone and you're just so in the moment of accepting the other individual in a state of joy. So we have experienced that. I say this because sometimes it feels like, I don't know if I can do this work. There's too many things to keep in my head. There's too many things to not mess up. There's too many things that can go wrong. But when you are in those states, it's able to kind of like get you out of those stress cycles as well. Yes, okay, well. Here's the last. So starting into the landscape view, I'll do a little other piece of my introduction. So as Emily noted, some of the things that I do, a couple of other pieces I'll add is my full name is José Guadalupe Adonis González Rosales León. I often say that I am an educator by training, I'm a teacher by training. I'm also a conservationist kind of by aspiration and practice. And then I'm also an artist just kind of by creation and some of the other work that I do. I'm Mexicano by birth. I'm a U.S. citizen through naturalization. I'm Latino by social cultural identity. I'm Chicano by social political identity. And I'm Hispanic by census count. And so I do that as a way to kind of say, this is kind of the multitude of, like, when we talk about identities, but also about introductions. And a simple example about when we talk about, like, oh, it's the system that we're in, and it forces you to, like, be defined in a specific way, and it may seem abstract. But for me, it was as simple as knowing that when I was born, that was my full given birth name. And it was fine until I came to the U.S. And in the U.S., pretty quickly, not just through, like, culture, but through the experience of going through the DMV, for example, the Department of Motor Vehicles, it was like, wait, no. So what's your actual first name? And I'm like, well, what do you mean? Like, I go by Lupe. That's in Mexico. I'm Lupe. Like, but that's not on here. Like, well, it's short for Guadalupe. Like, yeah, but is that your first name? Well, no, but. And so in the U.S., I became Jose. Or Jose. And then same thing with the last names in terms of, like, well, which is your last name? Well, González Rosales. So that means you're. So the last name, that's your dad? I'm like, no, that's my mom. See, it goes dad and then mom, and that's the last name. Well, you can't have it that way. So I became Jose González. So that's the process by which I mean that at that point, I was not really paying attention, but it serves as an example of, like, what do we mean about what's the space that begins to say, you're normal, you're not normal, would you like to be normal? Here's some options, right? Whether you like them or not, that's not really what we're asking. It's like, this is what's going to create a normal space. And so for the landscape, I say this because for the landscape view, when we sometimes talk about this, all of the broad work of, like, equity and inclusion and diversity, and we use all these terms, is to try to provide the context to kind of say, this isn't just made up. Like, it wasn't just my personal experience of going through the DMV and saying this stuff, and, like, this is just one example, and it's only real to me. So how many of you are familiar with the Green 2.0 report? You in? Okay. You can just go on to diversegreen.org or look for Green 2.0 report. So this came out a few years ago, and it was important because it provided some of the data, some of the numbers, and some of the research behind what a lot of people of color were saying. Hey, we're not representative in the movement, or we hear that organizations are curious about being more diverse, but our experiences aren't really matching with that aspiration. And so this came out, and since then there's been subsequent reports to look at other pieces, for example, how people of color leave the field, the environmental field, because they're like, yeah, we're still putting data on the fact that we go into spaces and we don't really fit in. And so what that said at the beginning was that there's a green ceiling. That even though the demographics in the U.S. are continuing to shift and change, that's not really being represented in the environmental movement, and that there's an idea of a green ceiling in terms of leadership. So when you look at representative leadership across the field, it's not the same. Two is that the unconscious bias, discrimination, and insular recruiting is a factor. In other words, and this isn't to say that it's deliberate, hence the unconscious piece. It's not like, oh my God, I only want to hire a specific demographic of people. I only want to hire white men. It's not what is happening. What is happening is noticing that I'm not really paying attention in all the ways in which applicants enter this field. So it is easier for me to identify others that are representative of me, in which the space is easier to do that. And it has predominantly benefited those that are at the top now. So that's kind of beginning to look at that and how you unpack that. And the lackluster effort and its interest in addressing diversity was to basically say, we say we want to be here, but we're actually doing this here. And we're not talking about this camp. We keep talking about, like, yes, we're really interested and excited in doing it, but here is what the data is actually showing. So what do you mean to do about that? And then in other pieces of kind of this work, so this is kind of this is the Nature of American study in 2017. We were just kind of looking at what is your relation, how do you relate to and understand nature? When we talk about nature in the outdoors, what comes up? And so two examples I want to show here is when you look at this question and this table, and the question basically is interest in hiking by race and ethnicity. And so they use some of the kind of the common demographics or kind of census classification. But you'll see that the options are, so interest in hiking, a lot, some, or none at all. If we look at the a lot and we look at the demographics here, you'll notice that there's a lot of interest from, we got Hispanic and some white and Asian. So then if you look at black, that's the lowest at 19%. And if you look at none at all, black is the highest. And then if we were to look at that same question and say, what about interest in walking outdoors? All of a sudden now the whole lot goes up where it's the black percentage that's the highest. So that's the kind of thing where we're looking at, so what's radically different? How is hiking compared to interest in walking outdoors? Interest in hiking compared to interest in walking outdoors is radically different. That's what we mean about the framing, the culture. Like, what is it about how we frame what's normative around something like hiking that affects it? Right? Because it isn't the interest in the outdoors part. It isn't, like, the connection to that. And we see this also. This is from the Outdoor Industry Association, the environmental and conservation space, the nature movement space, and also the outdoor industry space. One example is that, for example, Latino-Hispanic consumers, even though they're underrepresented in this industry, in the field, those that are in it tend to be overrepresented compared to the average outdoors enthusiast. So meaning spending more time outside than the average, considering themselves more outdoorsy than the average, and spending more money than the average. So it's important to look at that so we can really look at the nuances and understanding of breaking down the simplicity of the frames we often started with, which is like, oh, people just probably just don't like the outdoors. You know, the parks are there. They can choose to go. They just don't want to go, right? Or, well, you know, a lot of Latino families are poor, so they wouldn't be interested in it. And then I often say, well, yeah, that may be true in some cases, but if the quinceañera is going to happen, the resources show up. It's about the value. And if you get that, you get it. And if you don't, what that means is that when a community values something, there's investment of resources in it. And also from the Outdoor Industry Association is to kind of note that in terms of the rates, quote-unquote Asian rates are going up, white are relatively stable plateauing. Hispanic are slightly growing up, but black is still highly underrepresented. And this is important when I said at the beginning to not just say all people of color and then fill in the blank. it's important to look at what are some of the cultural characteristics and engagements, not just for blocks of demographics, but even getting more granular as we begin to look at the question of, well, who do we want to engage? And then lastly, looking at kind of the environmental and kind of climate justice space. This is from the Green Latinos Earth Justice survey back in 2015, and also from the American Climate Values survey. And this was looking at the question of green is extremely important, red not that or all important, or I don't know. And that 85% of Latinos believe it is extremely important or very important to reduce smog and air pollution. 84% say the U.S. should mandate more clean energy sources like solar and wind power. 86% support increased conservation of water. 79% believe it's extremely very important to protect our nation's wildlife, public lands, and endangered species, and support state clean energy standards to prevent global warming and climate change. So that high percentage, I imagine for some of you, it's not a surprise. If for any of you it is, welcome to now. Because kind of the big takeaway from here is that who we consider kind of quote-unquote underrepresented or marginalized identity in these, in many of these spaces actually is they express a greater level of concern but also oriented to action around issues like climate change, more so than the total population. So you look at are we convinced that climate change is happening? African Americans, 74%. Asian Americans, 83%. Hispanic Latino Americans, 73%. Versus all American adults at 71%. So it is that the question is like, is climate change happening? Is it real and is it a danger? Yes. And so I framed that because one of the first shifting of the language was away from do people of color, and if you can't see me at home, I'm using people of color in air quotes. There's a reason behind that. I'll get to that. Is that, oh, they don't care or they're not interested. They don't want to be engaged. To reframing it to say, why might they be underrepresented in XYZ spaces? And how are they engaged in ways that we may not know or didn't pay attention to until surprise we started looking and putting research to it? So that's one of the first frames. What does it count for underrepresentation? And it also can lead us into the question of saying, well, if concern is here or representation is here, at home I'm saying if concern is high and representation is below that, so what's happening in this? What are other things that can account for that gap? And this is where we can talk about some of the systematic practices that you can be the best possible, and you might make it, but the system is still kind of tilted in favor against you or preference for somebody else. And that doesn't make somebody else a bad person, or that they're not working just as hard or harder. It just means kind of like when you're swimming at the ocean, it's one thing to be swimming with the current, it's another thing to be swimming at the same level of effort against the current. If that's appropriate for the conservancy. Okay. So more framing for this, and the artist here is Vienna Rai. If you are on Instagram, I recommend you follow them. They're really good at being able to provide visually some striking information that you may agree or disagree with it, but I don't think they are inaccurate in what the point they're trying to make. Some more framing around some of the terms and words. And I'm going to start by sharing with you how when I hear some of the things like radical and revolution, to me they're a little bit more grounding than how people might think it's like, oh, goodness, it's the end of the world, and it means everything has to be different in ways in which they've never been before. And I use radical because the root of the word radical is root. So, especially of change or action relating to or affecting the fundamental nature of something, far-reaching or thorough, and yet it comes from forming the root and inherent. So I look at how does this work get us back to the root of where we are and where we've been. So what does that look like? And that helps me whenever I'm feeling too much of kind of the doom and gloom, and be able to say, as humans, we actually know how to do this. We may not be paying attention to the people that have known how to do this the longest, and this is where you can get into the conversation around like ancestral knowledge and indigenous knowledge, for example, to say, oh, they have been doing this. And we either A, forgot, we either B, ignored it, or C, we eliminated it. So what does it look like to undo that? And revolutionary, a dramatic and wide-reaching change in the way something works or is organized or in people's ideas about it, an instance are evolving, I look at that idea of revolveré, to roll back, that it's cyclical. There's a way we can, revolution is about coming back to some of those forces. And then also, because there may be the feeling of, I don't know what's the new term, right? So I thought it was just diversity, and then people were talking about equity and then inclusion, and now we're talking about justice and equity and inclusion and diversity, and I don't know like which one goes first and what order. And then I don't know what's the new term that's being used. It's almost like you missed the Tuesday 8 o'clock meeting, right? There is no Tuesday 8 o'clock meeting, so no. But it's important. So that for me, it's not about getting overly stuck in what the word is, but understanding the direction and framework. And so say justice-oriented work, it's about, you know, to use Martin Luther King Jr., that arc of justice. Are we clear about where we want to go compared to getting confused about what the path is supposed to look like? And I share this. This is from the Green Lining Institute, so from here in Oakland as well, because I like how they framed it to be able to say, some of the stuff is evolving, but it's about increasing greater equity, inclusion, greater justice. It's about the direction that we're moving. And in the 1960s and 70s, you know, that was some of the first initial work to really systematically undo what has been in place for 200 years. Slavery, Jim Crow laws, a lot of which still being undone, but it was to be able to have something like the Civil Rights Act, right? Kind of say, hey, what if we actually had a law that could be enforced, right, for cultural change? And that really was around tolerance. Kind of like, okay, fine, you have the right to vote. And part of that was to say, to satisfy moral arguments for equality and mitigate the rising disruption. Kind of grew into multiculturalism and awareness, kind of understanding, hey, we are a nation of immigrants that we're willing not to accept. There's different types of immigrants, not the same immigrants as before. And yeah, this is where we have these conversations of the melting pot or the salad bowl, and how we could celebrate each other's differences. And we could have kind of cultural awareness and cultural celebration day. And ideally, that was to kind of prepare for the fact that the demographics are still changing. And they're going to continue to change into 2040, 2050, where the U.S. is going to be, quote-unquote, minority-majority nation. That you can't undo, at least not morally. And that's important because we cannot have the same conservation successes in the future that we had in the past by relying on the same model and the same demographic. So to me, that's always an excitement of opportunity to say, hey, here's an opportunity to do this better and stronger, rather than like having a sense of loss. And I question that sense of like, what do you feel is being lost? Because we can investigate. So today, diversity and moving forward, and you'll hear a lot more different cases for it, but that's really about ensuring that representation, for example, in corporations, in government, in decision-making institutions, right, actually reflect the community. And sometimes you'll see this as the business case, but there's a lot, it incorporates a lot of the other things. Say, guess what? Diversity is actually very useful and important. And in the same way that we value biodiversity and a social diversity really brings strength to the work that we do. And you'll see a host of other terms, try to weave some of these connections. For example, intersectionality, right? We're not going to explore that very deep now, but that's an important term to help explain the ways in which having multiple identities matters, both in the way, not just because, you know, you're beautiful and unique and you're all of this. It's more like, oh, because you are Black and a woman, it means the system isn't really ready to help you as that. It can be ready to help you as Black, maybe. It can be maybe ready to help you as a woman. But if you're a Black woman, there might be gaps in which you want to fall in. So that's some of the foundational work around intersectionality. And I myself try to be careful in how I say intersectional if maybe I mean interconnected. Right? So I can say, oh yeah, this is interconnected work. But it may not be intersectional work. Also, to the terms like decolonizing or indigenizing, the age of social media has kind of already made it easier to share some of this content. And so I say this because to me, I still go back and say, what is the direction? What is the flow? Where do these terms fit in understanding kind of where we want to go? You're not expected to read this. I'm just kind of giving you the source. This is from the AORTA Collective, Anti-Oppression Resource and Training Alliance, so that I can look at to say, what does the system look like if it's exclusionary, strictly exclusionary, where by design, intention, or disregard, it proactively or inadvertently reinforces exclusion, disempowerment, marginalization, discrimination, and so forth. Right? We'd like to think that ideally in the U.S. that doesn't exist anymore, intentionally, so to speak. But unintentionally, there's still spaces where that is exactly what it says. And sometimes we may not notice it until it affects our particular set of identities. So, for example, around gender, right? It's one thing to say, for reproductive rights or birth control, as a woman, you need to do this, 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 and this. As a man, oh, well, that's not a problem for men, right? Imagine what it would look like if the same types of requirements or things to go through apply to men as well. That's like one example around that. All the way to neutrality, where you sometimes think, well, it's neutral, and this is kind of where you sometimes say, I don't see color, or I'm colorblind. It may sound innocuous, because you're like, no, you know, just I see you as a human. The danger of that is kind of not acknowledging to be able to say, well, actually, the difference you bring into this space is highly valuable and important. That is actually an asset. Because if you really think about it, say, I don't see color, it's another way to say, I don't see you, depending on what the default is. So multiculturalist approach, cultural competency approach, all the way to social justice approach, which is really focused on acknowledging a system of oppression and structural and institutional barriers based on things like race, ethnicity, gender, class, and so forth. But really to work beyond the individual, and we don't get overly stuck on the fact when somebody says, you as an individual are being discriminatory, you as an individual are being racist. Might be true, may not be. What happens when it's not true, but systematically there's still something that's going to benefit that person? That's when the hard work comes in. And I put this because part of like the weaving this whole structure together, this is from Dr. Rupa Myra. She presented this last year at Bioneers, is when people are saying, well, there's this happening, and there's this happening, and there's this happening. And intersectionality happens in these different pieces. And you hear all these different types of terms that are up on the screen. This is just one way to organize them to kind of say, at the root of it, can I understand, I think, what is happening, rather than getting me overly caught up on, like, fighting and defending each of these pieces. Right? And I share this because we can get overly caught up on, like, what those terms mean. But I'm going to share what Dr. Rupa Myra said to reground it in what I said at the beginning about radical and revolutionary. And she put on here, to me, to be colonized means to be disconnected and disintegrated from our ancestry, from the earth, from our indigeneity, our earth-connected self. We all come from earth-connected people, people who once lived in deep connection to the rhythms of nature. I believe it is not a coincidence that the colonization of this land happened at the same time the Europeans were burning hundreds and of thousands of witches, those women who carried the traditional indigenous knowledge of the tribes of Europe. This is to kind of say, surprise, you're all victims of colonization. But also not to dismiss it in such a way that it's kind of, it's just historical. No, it's just, you know, that's happened in the past. How does this apply to now? This is important because this is an introduction. And again, this is for you to have awareness. Okay? This isn't to be like, oh my God, what do I have to understand all of this? Maybe. But you can begin to look at different work in the nature movement, in the outdoor industry movement, conservation movement, and some of the language and narratives that are happening there to kind of see how this can be grounded in. How many of you have read Richard Roof's book, Last Child in the Woods? A few of you, right? And what's the term that he kind of coins there or is mentioning it's important to know?
Nature deficit,
right? Now, he's not calling it his decolonization disorder, right? Probably would not have sold in the same way or to the same audience. But it's still rooted in the fact to say there's a disconnection from nature. And when we can explore that a little deeper, I just realized that this has been recorded. So sorry, Rich. It's going to be good for later. I know Richard, so we have some of these conversations. But I want to share that because I also appreciate him being able to lean into that, to be able to say, you know, when I wrote this, I was hoping that it would reach people. It's very different to know which people it reached and which ones it didn't and why. And the thesis of, like, being disconnected to nature is still valid, but we can explore that a little deeper as to, well, what does nature mean and in what context to different communities. And similarly, this is from Rachel Edwards. The world will tell us that putting ourselves first is selfish because we're supposed to be the mules and carry the weight of the world on our backs. I'd say for me, putting ourselves first looks like being our truest self without the worry of what someone thinks of us. Putting ourselves first is decolonizing. Think about it. Black women have always had to take care of others before considering themselves. This dates back to American slavery. So there's a lot packed in there. But the expression is still the same about, like, when we're going to start using a word of decolonizing, what is it that we're trying to undo? What is it we're trying to remember? And what is it that we're trying to go back to and not go back to? So I put this because decolonizing is a relatively common word right now. And I put this to one is say it's not easy when you say, okay, great, we're going to decolonize. I'm like, wait, who is you and what do you do and what are you doing? Just careful what you're going to do with that, right? Because one, it's not just purely a metaphor. And two, well, sometimes it kind of is a metaphor and more than a metaphor. So what are the different ways in which it's being used? So that you can understand to be able to say, yeah, we're not going to say that as an organization we're doing decolonizing work. But it can mean that we understand the context that it's used and see how that's applicable in the work that we do. And that keeps you a little bit more honest and also you don't set yourself up for immediate failure. One of them in terms of that it's not easy, this comes from Nelson Maldonado Torres' 10 Thesis. And in here he writes, so typical responses to raising the question about the meaning and significance of colonization and decolonization are visceral and aim to relativize, the value of the questions as well as to undermine the position of the colonized as a questioner. So who's bringing this up and why? The bad faith responses are eminently predictable. For example, this happened in the past, and we need to move forward. Well, my ancestors were also colonized. My parents were poor. I am also othered. In truth, we're all racist. My wife or husband or best friend is one of you. I say, well, my friend is also on the back. I try to join, but they reject me. Or if you keep doing this, the university or the organization, for example, will be destroyed, the country will perish, or all whites will leave. And I am just afraid for what they can do to me and my family. That's the visceral component. So the responses also include the assertion that, for example, all lives matter as a counter to those who declare that Black lives matter in a context where Blacks are disproportionately killed and imprisoned by the security forces and the judicial system of the modern state. It misses the point that while our lives are supposed to matter, a commonsensical point of departure is that Black lives tend to be taken as a continued exception, which we do see to this day. And we can get into arguments over how real and how it applies to you and not, but I can argue that if you want to do the systematic research that others have done, it bears out. And so this is one of many examples that demonstrates the ways in which liberal abstract universalisms are often used against rather than in favor of concrete struggles for freedom, equality, and related political rights. That's what makes this hard. And from Decolonization is Not a Metaphor by Eve Tuck and Wayne Yan, they were stating that the word is being overused. You're saying decolonize your school, decolonize your diet, decolonize your syllabus. And it might have the right intention, but they're arguing could. The way I think about it, it's kind of like you make it the new coconut water, right? And then you can't actually have coconut water because we made it the new coconut water. Decolonizing brings about the repatriation of indigenous land and life. It is not a metaphor for other things we want to do to improve our societies and schools. The easy adoption of decolonizing discourse by educational advocacy and scholarship, evidenced by the increasing number of calls to decolonize our schools or use decolonizing methods or decolonize student thinking, turns decolonizing into a metaphor. Then it kind of goes on to say that even though those may be important goals, that's really a larger framework of social justice. And they're trying to ground it on saying that decolonization should be about giving back to the land. It's about that kind of settler-colonial relationship, settler-native slave, to be able to say, you took this land by force and violence. To decolonize means to actually return that. Right? So they've narrowed it in that way. Well, and so that gets us to these types of images. Right? To be able to say, why those have power in the narrative that comes behind these images. Also, Nelson Maldonado Torres says that for them, that it's important to be able to then, we get you trying to say different things, so tease out the terms a little bit more. In contrast, coloniality and decoloniality, so not just decolonization, refers to the logic, metaphysics, ontology, and matrix of power created by the massive processes of colonization and decolonization. What they're getting at is to be able to say, we often will talk about colonization again as something that happened in the past. That's obviously not something we do anymore, right? We don't just sail away, find a new continent, and kind of become settlers, take it over, and whatnot. That was all back in the 1700s, maybe 1800s. Not 100% accurate. And yet what they're trying to get at, that it's too easy to continue to think about, that's also one of our biases, to think, oh, that's happened in the past, even if it was just 30 years ago. And so what they're saying, we don't have to talk about colonization or decolonization if we look at just what coloniality as a construct is, which is about power relationships. And so we have conversations around privilege and power and power, systems of power and whatnot, is to pay attention. Is this a system that we used in the past that we're still using now? But we are pretty sure what kind of effect it's going to have. So that's what they have on there. The seek to dismantle coloniality and to open up multiple other forms of being in the world. And that leads us to conversations about other ways of knowing, other ways of being, other ways of doing. So that we move from this to understanding that that's one way of engaging and understanding and interacting with the world. And us practicing it is kind of what brought us to where we are now. But there are other ways of engaging with, especially with nature, for example. So this is adaptive by Charles Thomas from original work done by Edwin Nichols. This is looking at philosophical aspects of cultural difference to kind of, and again, these are meant as starting points. They're not meant as boxes. It's to say, oh, great, you all fit in there. It's more like, okay, this can help me maybe understand a perspective that can come from there. And so on the top, it says European or Euro-American. So you can think of like the Western Europe scientific revolution and scientific method, right, that came about our way of understanding and engaging with the world, where the axiology was human object, whereas I am the human and this is the object, and the highest value is in the acquisition of the object. You see that in things like the outdoor industry, where I'm going to conquer the mountain or bag that peak. I'm going to crush the whatever it might be, right? It's a relationship of like, I am the dominant human. Now, you might not always feel that, or you might think, well, that's not really me, but that's kind of the cultural engagement that we've constructed around it. And the epistemology, kind of the way in which we relate and value things, both of these, is knowing through counting and measuring. So, for example, resource management. We have a national forest. We gather data and information, right? For timber production. Again, there's nothing wrong with that because it's an important set of tools and ways to understand the world. But there's a difference between saying, this is a tree that's separate from me, and I can count it and measure it and gather information and classify it and label it, right, and do all of that. Then if we go all the way to the bottom, and so for some indigenous perspectives of the Americas, for example, there are more human multiverse, and that it sees that the relationship is also through activity, symbolic imagery, and rhythm. And something like a rain dance, it's the way we communicate and interact with nature, but also that there's familiar spirits in the space. So the tree is a tree, not arguing that it's not a tree in the way that we also understand it, but it can also have connections to familiar spirits. And if that's not your experience, it can be hard to kind of think of that worldview or perspective. And the closest you might get to, you know, like how Disney simplifies it and infantilizes it, right? With a movie like Brother Bear. So, no disrespect to Disney. I'm just saying, like, that might be the way in which we get that framing. Unless you actually are invited to and practice in ceremonial spaces. So it helps us kind of understand that when we talk to the larger piece of colonization, is to break it down to see how we might still be perpetuating this mechanistic reductionist worldview. Now, nothing wrong with that. It's just to be saying, are we saying this is the only way that we're supporting the space? And so this is from Michelle Holliday. She was saying, well, how do I think about this? So what do we do? What's the flipping that I can do about this? And if I can now think about all these other terms that we're trying to promote, like stewardship, equity, thrivability, thriving, a lot of things that we sometimes are trying to collect right now to say to do better, do different. And so to flip around this life-honoring worldview, kind of, again, that revolution, that reconnection. Oops. There we go. And I like this one because it provides some of this framing that there's a healing that we're looking for. And you hear this in some of the messaging. This is, again, the art by Vienna Rai. And it says, none of us are well until all of us are well. And it adds to the work that we're doing now around different communities to say, you know, like, my liberation is connected to your liberation. Right? There's a way to kind of say, let's restore some of this humanity into it. But what does that really mean? Or as the artist Ernesto Llerena from Hecho con Ganas says, I choose to heal severed connections. Getting at to where were these severed connections from, they came kind of from that colonizing space. So as I close here for to go to the last section, to to me, this helps organize this kind of saying the future is, when we say JEDI or JADE. I like JADE because it makes justice and diversity outcomes of equity and inclusion work. It makes it justice oriented. It's not just interconnected, but intersectional. It's moving from diversity to decolonizing, with indigenizing as one component of that. They don't mean the same. And that it's fluent, and I put quantum. There's a spectrum to it. And that's where we're getting at the language that a lot of people say, sin frontera, without borders. And to me, that's just all natural. Got a question?
Question from the audience.
Yes.
What does JEDI stand for?
So JEDI is one of the, acronyms. Is that the right term? To stand for justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion. So you might see those letters rearranged in different ways, but those are the common terms. Good question. And also to get at, when we see some of these images, I think that is, again, this is the NRI again, the future is femme, black, brown, trans, queer, non-binary. To me, it's, you know, I ground it into what I shared before, and it's not that quote-unquote radical and revolutionary in the way that we might presume is too far out there for us, but it's a way to say, this is actually grounded in deeper and simpler truth that we either, again, didn't pay attention to before, ignored, or erased. And these are ways of kind of it coming back. So, solutionary direction. Solutionary, unless I am corrected, is a term that I heard Rue Mapp about for use several years ago. That's really useful and cool. You yourself being a solutionary. And I like this quote, I like to quote a lot of people, Michael Luther King Jr. is no exception. But I like this quote from him because a lot of the work that sometimes we do now, we say, you need to approach this with love, or we kind of may use terms that we feel, how's that even applicable in some of the structural work that we do, right? Or love doesn't pay the bills, or like all of these things to say, that sounds nice, but how is that even connected to the real issues that we have to deal with? And like this quote said, for me, it connected it. Say, what is needed is a realization that power without love is reckless and abusive. And that love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice. And justice at its best is love correcting everything that stands against love. And this is what we must see as we move on. And it connected me to this phrase by Scott Mamadev, who from the book, essay, I think it's The First American Use of Land, to say, you say that I use the land, and I reply, yes, it is true, but it is not the first truth. The first truth is that I love the land. I see that it is beautiful, I delight in it, I am alive in it. One way is to embrace traditional indigenous law, which is rooted in nature and holds individuals accountable for their actions in a reciprocal relationship with the environment. Realigning existing policies and management could work to create more resilient systems. So this is researcher Don Honkins, St. Miwok. So I see this as like a series of connections to say, we can say we're going to push this work with love. What does that mean? It actually does matter with the work that we do, and it's grounded in the actual management practices that we can have now and pursue, and that it's not, it reminds us of how this is additive and not exclusive of each other. We're not saying, let's use traditional ecological knowledge to mean let's decolonize by doing it the way that it was 200 years ago. Not most people are saying that to mean let's undo everything. I had an elder once that's like, I'm not saying that I want to give away my coffee pot. Like, you're misunderstanding me. I like this. What I'm saying is that the relationship and approach that we have with the land has to be restored in a way that we have undone it. Right? So saying it's a way to kind of separate what we mean with modernity as well. And another practice, something that I subscribe to, is network leading. So these are four network leading principles that also begins to look at how the system pieces that we've created, especially in corporate America, for example, that there's a focus on growth, on control, on yourself, on garnering resources, and on the particular, to shift it to the focusing on the mission, on trust, on others, on sharing resources and focusing on the whole. So this is the work of Dr. Jane Wayne Skiller, which comes down to mission, not organization, trust, not control, humility, not brand, constellations, not stars. It's a series of practices based on research from her case studies about, for example, what makes nonprofits much more successful with limited resources and when you have a collective mission. So it's not, again, it's not just like, oh, cool. Sure, it sounds like an EDPS. For her, it's like, I want to actually study and see what has made these organizations successful. And this is what she distilled. And it's grounded on the work that a lot of other individuals are doing now. For example, on network ecology. Kind of say we're still human. We still have our practice and system. But we can really be more attentive at what are the natural systems reminding us of what can be effective in the way that we do. Fostering connection. So this is the network weaver principle and mindset. Cultivating collaborations. Remembering abundance. Honoring differences. Actually, I guess I'll leave it a minute for the people in the audience that you're reading this. I'll read one, for example. So remember abundance. Networks function not just because everyone involved does their piece, but because the flow of resources within the network create a whole greater than the sum of the parts, generated by and increasing a practice of abundance. So, for example, nurse logs are dead trees that provide water and nutrients to grow new trees and other species. Success from this can look like vitality and a feeling of fullness rather than a feeling of burnout. When you're experiencing burnout in a workplace, one of the indicators might be because you're doing the opposite of this. You might be practicing a scarcity mentality, for example, or that might be what's kind of part of the predominant culture. And you'll hear it in the literature when we talk about, oh, can we shift that to a mind-grown set, or can we shift that to value-added perspective rather than like scarcity? And that's important because it's also based on the work that we approach communities and say, oh, these poor people need this, this, and this, and we are the ones that are going to help them with that. Rather than saying this community has found a way to be resilient, how are they doing that? What are they, and what do they need so we can better support them to create more of it? So these spaces do hold tension, and then broadcast and translate. So meaning, for example, that able to identify, share, and hold tensions and contradictions within the group that is navigated gracefully can build strength. How to have difficult conversations. How to hold spaces of tension to actually provide an outcome rather than just saying, well, this is too hard and we don't touch it. So those are some of those examples. And at the end is see the whole. Networks work best when all members operate from a network mindset, holding the whole network as a place of decision-making. Equity and power analysis paired with ongoing learning and leadership development are critical. This can work. This does work. It doesn't mean that everybody does this, and some people continue to do the opposite of this. The lessons here to be able to say how there are still practices that you can institute within your teams, within your organization, in the field, to do different and better. I like this from artist Greg Deal. This is from Twitter. Today I was asked, what is most important to indigenous people? The land, protecting traditions, your language, or your people? And I told them, those are all the same thing. It's all the larger network. They're not separate. They're not to be separate in the way that you might presume they can, thinking about the mechanistic production and worldview. So some considerations and common pitfalls. The three pieces I'll share here quickly. I have implicit bias and fragility. So there's a whole series of training you can do on that. oppressive dominant work culture, there's a whole series of training you can do on that, and inclusive narrative, same. I'm going to give you some snapshots of what these can look like. So on implicit or implicit cognitive bias, three things to remember. One is your bias. If you say, oh, I'm not biased, that's like, again, saying I'm colorblind. If you can hold that idea, it does not make you that accurate or correct. And that's, you can do the work on that. We can show you the research around cognitive science. It's not like a personal opinion. And its implications, meaning that it does affect the way in which we create spaces and relate to each other. And also that having bias isn't bad by itself. It is adaptive, meaning it's natural. It's just literally the way, it is the way our brains are wired. And that we know that bias exists, identify what the bias may be, and look at the way to mitigate or interrupt it. It's not about being 100% successful. It's about doing the practices so it doesn't dominate the decision-making that you make. The quote-unquote simplicity of bias, as I have, that it's adaptive, meaning back when we were quote-unquote cave people, we had to evolve with our surroundings, and our brains got pretty good about dealing with information in specific ways. That doesn't mean they were, and for survival specifically. But we have it often because of three things. One is we often have too much information. Right now, there's so much information flowing into our senses, you're not processing it at all consciously. It's also making a way in unconsciously, but you're not paying attention to all the sounds, to all the visual stimuli, to everything that probably don't even pay attention to what you actually do, what your feet are doing. All of that is coming in. And so we filter it to avoid information overload. At the same time, we don't know enough. We try to make meaning out of what's going around us, and we want to be able to have predictability in our life. So we fill in the gaps and sometimes jump to conclusions because of that. If all of a sudden you all heard what you took to be a loud elephant noise outside, it would be safe to assume that you're like, oh, what is going on? Why is there an elephant outside? What could have, what are we doing? Should we do something? Rather than just like, oh, got it. Tuesday afternoon at the conservancy. That's what happens. You're an elephant. I say that with humor because it goes to the fact that your brain wants to make sense of it. Without even knowing, all you heard was sound. So we are primed to act fast, and we jump to conclusions to act on the present. Humans are pretty good about that. We are pretty present-oriented, and we're pretty good about wanting to not miss an opportunity. There's a lot of things working on us. Even classic studies to be able to say to kids, you can have the candy bar, right? You can have the candy bar or the orange, depending. Or you can have two candy bars if you wait longer. You can have one candy bar if you want to have it right now. And a lot of times you pick over now. Right. And so we've done this to construct our cognitive models of the world. It's just how we move in the world and what makes sense to us. So to remember this is to keep in mind that we don't see everything. Whenever something's happening, say like, what may I not be seeing? Meaning searching can conjure illusions. Am I actually seeing what I think I'm seeing? Quick decisions can be seriously flawed. Do I actually need to decide right now on this, or do I have time to look at alternative options and considerations? Again, that may not be true all the time. Sometimes you do need to decide at the moment, but often we have developed a sense of urgency that may not need to be there for that moment, which leads to how we see the world in particular ways or what is our constructed reality. So what you're experiencing right now is the collection of your senses, putting the picture together in your brain and saying, this is what reality is. It's not to get like overly you know, weird or mystical on you and say like, oh my God, there's no objective reality. It's not that. It is important because if you ever saw, for example, the pictures of the blue dress or the gold white dress, there's still arguments about that. The dress is the same color. And the source for this is Buster Benson, and I forget who the visual artist for this is on there on the source. But this is like just one visual of like a host of the biases. And so when you see this, there's no expectation that you're going to be like, oh, great, let me go ahead and memorize all of these and see what's going to be happening. But I'm showing this to kind of see what you are working with and against at the same time. And they have these as kind of four categories of the too much information, not enough meaning, need to act fast, what should we remember? And you might see other visuals like these, then 20 cognitive biases that screw up your decision. Everything from an availability heuristic to a blind spot to confirmation bias is a classic one, overconfidence, information bias. So again, the idea is that I'm going to remember all of these. But it might be useful for you to look at and say, huh, which of these five of you are the most prone to? Are there three that I find myself, well, yep, I keep falling into those. And you can do something like take the implicit association test out of Harvard University just to kind of see what the information I give you. Like you can go online and sign up for that and take that. And it can tell you some of this information. But also like this from Dr. Matthew Lieberman, who's also two slides ahead. He's a neuroscientist at UCLA. And actually like how he put, he was framing how he's saying there's uncognitive, there's implicit bias. Right? We do it without really knowing that it's filtering it in this way. And there's conscious decision making, like, oh, I know what I'm doing. Right? And he said, often, like, some of this work is hard because it's not to say, oh, well, it's all implicit, so, you know, I just wire that way. I don't mean to be discriminatory in that way. Like, well, that's not acceptable. Right? We can work with that, but that doesn't fix it all. By giving you the information and say, you know, the results show that you're pretty biased on gender. And you're like, well, you know, boys are going to be boys. What can I do? Not acceptable. Right? I say this because it's not just about that work. And it also is not that people are consciously saying, oh, I'm going to discriminate against you on this. What he's saying that in the middle is what the constructed reality that we make in between there. And he calls it seeing. And I like that because in some of kind of the more of the social science work for this, we often say a phrase like, oh, I see. And so I like how that is an anchor point to be able to say, what can that mean? And he and his colleagues broke this down to kind of four general categories. And the acronym is COST, C-O-S-T. So the buckets are corner cutting, objectivism, self-protection, and time and money. So this at least helps a little bit to be able to say, oh, are my biases around corner cutting? Am I using all my heuristic, my shortcuts to just like get to this? Is it objectivism, right? Thinking that what I see is real until you're shown otherwise. Self-protection. We're pretty good about feeling good about ourselves without thinking about it too much. It's not to say you shouldn't affirm yourself, but we're more prone to think we're right and somebody else is wrong. Rather than like, huh, I guess I'm wrong and you're right. Rather than like, wait, have you really considered that you could not be right in that way? And time and money. So these are things like some cost fallacies to kind of be able to say, I already invested in this, I don't want to be losing. So we have kind of some biases around working against time. And the fragility component comes in here. You'll especially see this around race and gender. So like, my fragility, male fragility, that an amount of stress becomes intolerable, triggering a range of defensive moves. And I put this with bias because it can come in the way that we don't want to accept that our viewpoints come from a biased frame of reference. I am pretty objective. You must be the one that's seeing it in that way. That's different. We want to remain objective and neutral, resenting when a marginalized group becomes central in society, or it's those people that are now getting everything. They're not working. They didn't work as hard for it like I did. And prioritizing comfort and stability over equity. We should be able to just have a nice conversation around this. Why is it always so hard? Or why can't people just follow the directions that a law officer gives them? And the takeaway are that when we are the group in power, it's hard to get called out on abusing that power, and it's to be challenged on having that power or getting asked to share that power, especially if we didn't even realize we had that power to begin with. So that's the conversation around, like, all of a sudden, oh, wait, I'm privileged? No, that can't be right. So for example, I'm privileged on gender. Part of the work for me is to see what does that mean and implication in this book. So you can read, for example, a book like White Fragility as a starting point for that. The oppressive dominant cultures, I try really hard not to insert memes, but I think it's just another one, is to think about the ways that we value time, process, and outcomes. Like, you all have a project tomorrow. What comes to mind about how important time is? Who values it in what ways? What's the process that we take to make that decision? And what should that outcome look like? In an article titled White Supremacy Culture, so this is from the CWS workshop. Again, this is about having you be familiar with what the discourse is. Okay? This isn't me saying, like, here's your problem, here's what you need to fix. It may be true, but that's not for me to say that without even engaging in a strategic approach about what it is that you're doing. But you can look at things like this to be able to say, huh, perfectionism, sense of urgency, worship of the written word, and thinking, well, this is not just normal. That's the first investigation, to say, ah, that may be a normative culture that we didn't think about where it came from, why it's valued and important, and who does it prefer over others. And we get into things like, what is considered normal in setting the standard for judging values? So for example, what are the correct characteristics of a good employee here? And who fits those and who doesn't, and why? Who then suddenly is no longer a cultural fit? They're not a fit for the work culture of this organization. What is that? Okay. What is rewarded? Is there encouragement to compete compared to collaborative decision-making? Are decisions based on a common good? Kind of like I told you about the network meeting, right? They say, well, you know, here we encourage everybody to do their best, but don't make mistakes. Mistakes are not supported and encouraged. So what behaviors are considered uncomfortable? Conflict, a loud voice, crying, somebody is overly emotional, and that's not a good fit for leadership. Somebody is authoritative versus authoritarian, right? Or they're a good leader versus they're too bossy. And then you begin to see, is that set according to gender? Is that according to other? And who is included in the decision-making process? What is the rationale? And is that an actual policy or is that more of a cultural default? Let's see, last one. So guiding questions are, how do I feel about this? This is a huge triggering piece. This is where people get really uncomfortable. They start to tune out. They're like, oh, that's not me. Or like, no, yeah, we do that differently. It is hard. And that's usually where, say, cognitive therapy is good for this. Where I feel this. And it leads me to think this. And it leads me to act in this way. And is that who I actually know that I am or want to be? And if it's not, then you say, good, I'm just going to sit in my feelings then, rather than do something that becomes behaviors and it impacts the culture. And how is it valued in your organization? What are the implications? What were the characteristics, useful and not useful? So you can practice antidotes, for example. There's a culture of learning and appreciation. You can have values and process goals. You can role play ways how to handle conflict. There's a variety of things that you can do to say we can do a different behavior around this. And the last one for inclusive narratives, I like this because it says data makes you credible and stories make you memorable. But whose stories do we know? Who tells them to you now and whose remain untold? I could have just said, oh, it's easy. Just look at Amanda's webinar from last time. And you still should, because we work on this together. But also, a story I like to share is one of Rachel Carson and DDT. If I were to ask you, in the modern American environmental movement, we think of Rachel Carson and how important she was, she is, to the space. And that was kind of an inflection point, right? The book, we remember kind of Silent Spring being an important book, and it kind of brought attention to the DDT issue affecting the birds, and it led to the banning of DDT, and that was a great success. And it was. And she also went through a lot of stuff for being a woman. So all of that is part of it. And the story is still this, that the founders of EDF brought the original DDT lawsuit in Suffolk County, New York, where they showed that ospreys were having poor reproductive success and eggs that had not hatched contained high concentrations of DDT. The lawsuit ultimately led to a nationwide ban on DDT issued on June 14, 1972, by then EPA Administrator William Ruckelshaus. Like, that's the narrative. That's the success story. It tends to leave out the fact that the basis, like the human impact of it, came from Ralph, who then I realized when I first came, I was like, wait, his name's Rafael. He's a Chicano lawyer. I did not know that. Rafael Abascal, here from California. I think many of us know about him now and the work of the California Rural Legal Assistance. So the basis of that lawsuit was it became a marriage of convenience, turning over the lawsuit from the farm, six private farm workers. That's who the lawsuit was from. Giving it over to the EDF, and the EDF combined it to make it a stronger case for, like, the birds. No offense to the birds. And, like, that's part of what led to the success, to be able to prove human impact. But then they are completely written out. Part of that is we can look at, like, pesticides, while an important issue in their own right, became a metaphor for the larger power struggle, that such a subaltern group as farm workers have the audacity to challenge agribusiness methods was inconceivable. So that's what we mean about how these pieces come together. And this could be a narrative that can be completely wiped out, and communities continue to be led to believe that they never were part of this movement, they don't matter in this movement, their power base is to be challenged in this movement, and so forth and so forth. So these are the sources for that in terms of being able to look at some more information. And then in closing, this still plays out when we frame what is considered part of the conservation environmental narrative. If I show you this, what's the easy answer that you might say? Earth Day, right? And you would be right. It is the founding of Earth Day. But that's not a picture of Earth Day kids. That's a picture of the founding of Chicano Park in San Diego. And they are planting trees on Earth Day, but they're not celebrating Earth Day. They're celebrating the fact that they're getting their park by fighting to not have another California Highway Patrol station there instead. And the narrative continues even here in California when we are talking about demographic shifts, and we're talking about, oh, in 2013, so a couple years ago, this whole thing about Latinos, Hispanics becoming the biggest ethnic group in California. So that finally came to pass, right, plurality. But even as it was framed as surpassing whites for the first time, completely erased it, right, who were some of the other communities here from the beginning. So it could have said for the second time, but then people would have been like, wait, when was the first?
When it was owned by Mexico?
Yeah, and then the other one is that this still continues today, and this is very uncomfortable for a lot of us. Negative image in the media affects how Black people are treated in real life, for example, and it is noticed how we care so much about some specific conservation pieces. Anyone remember this lion? Yeah? Cecil the lion, right? We were outraged. Everything about, like, the lion has a name. So this is an injustice. Something should be done. We're not questioning the legality of the hunter, whether the permit was proper or not. So then Black Twitter, which again, not an actual separate Black Twitter site. Okay? this is meant with humor as well. It says, I'm going to start dressing like a lion. That way cops know that if it kill me, then white people will avenge me. Right? So Black Lions Matter became a thing. And you saw this If it helps, picture us as adorable safari animals. Whatever you do to need to get to the place where the murder of a person fills you with all the feelings of empathy you feel for Cecil, get there. And you saw this. You see this to now, right? I put this because Chris Rock has this as well. Are black men an endangered species? Of course not, because endangered species are actually protected by law. So that's harsh. So part of the work that I do is to bring culture into the space as an engagement piece. So we're going to talk about the hydrologic cycle. Great. We're going to start with an image that has a lot more cultural components and relevance. And we can talk about, yes, hydrologic cycle, carbon sequestration, endemic species, all with these pieces of engagement. And so extending that narrative component, that's how it's critical, right, to the space. And then my last slide is, this is important because a lot of times we talk about, like, how do we engage more people of color in the outdoors and the conservation movement and so forth. And it's like what I just said, there's a whole arc of it, and it's hard. And sometimes we want it to be easy by engaging intentional users. Those are already in. And it's not to say we shouldn't, because they're actually great connectors to this space. But this is the part to really investigate and say, well, what are the reasons that many don't want to be part of the movement intentionally? And we can't just say, oh, they're not interested, because that's the question we started with, to say, oh, it's not about being interested or having some connection. It's what's in place that reminds them that we're saying it's not for them. So I always close with practice, gratitude as a thing. So when you leave today, I recommend you give gratitude for yourself for holding the space for a lot of stuff that was just shared with you and at you, and then also with each other. Like, this is literally what you can start with today when you're like, what do? Turn to someone and say, I'm grateful to you because of this. And if it sounds kind of odd or weird or strange, I would ask you to think about why that might be. So with that, here are some resources that I always like to refer to and ask. Academic resources, when we say, where can we get some of this information? There's a lot of academics doing this. There's a lot of artists who are very important in the cultural space. And thank you. I think we're at time, so I don't know if you'll have a question or two, but I can always answer them after this one.
There's no questions.
Please.
Popping up right now. Do you guys have any questions?
You can do one or two, and then I can always follow via email. And I also want to respect your time.
Okay, well, thank you all for joining us, and thank you for being here, Jose. The Conservancy has been working on environmental equity, so we're very happy that you're here and in the space with us. And so, like I said in the beginning, please take at least two things that you learned today and share it with your team. Not everyone was able to make it today, so there's a lot of people we can share the information we learned today. And in the audience, please do the same, and we will wrap up and share this webinar recording later today.
Thank you. Good, I leave it. Thank you so much.
Information.